Good morning. Happy New Year's Eve. Christmas Eve. Oh, I'm a week ahead. I'm sorry. Those of you that are listening online and watching online, we're glad to have you with us this morning. You can join in the singing. You can join in the prayers. And you can listen real close to the word, because we're going to hear a good word today. And those that are guests and have not filled out a guest card, please do so. We'd like to know everyone that's here. And you might even get, I don't know, what would they get? We get thank you.
A nice letter from the pastor.
And I would like to introduce our bell choir. They're going to have the prelude this morning. And it is Good Christian Friends.
Thank you.
notice, the back row over here is the one facing you, is full. But if you'd like to be in the bell choir, we'll put another table out there. Our next, do you have something to say? Oh, not yet. Oh, yeah, lighting of the Advent wreath. Oh, the Bogowith family. We've already seen one of them. Jack did a good job lighting that candle.
When the angel Gabriel visited Mary, announcing God's plan for her to conceive and give birth to the Messiah, Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" And yet, only a few months later, Mary sings to Elizabeth, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name."
We, like Mary, hear God's call to be part of making God's dream for the salvation and flourishing a reality. And we question, how can this be? I am only. Yet we, like Mary, the onlys that make us hesitate, are gifts God can and will use as God's love transforms us into the bearers of good news.
Will you join us?
People who have encountered divine love has disrupted the status quo and ushers us into abundant life, marked by mutual love and peace that flows from the flourishing of all people.
We light these candles as signs of our shocking hope, our just peace, our fierce joy, and the love that transforms us. May love grow within us, transforming us into bold witnesses of God's salvation with our voices and our lives. Amen.
Music. Away in the manger, O come all ye faithful, sir us later. See all our stuff. Okay.
Thank you. with their children that would like to come up for the children's moment, just join me up here by the manger scene. Wonderful job. Thank you. Thank you. Hey, let's look at this. Look over here. Oh, this is marvelous. Look at all these lights. And what do you notice that wasn't here last week? The animals, yeah. We've got, what animals do we have here? We got several lambs. There's a donkey. Yeah, big old cow. All right. Cow's laying down, though. You may not be able to see him. He's resting. All right. And then what are the gifts? What do you think the gifts represent? Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Very good. Oh, I'm so excited for Christmas Eve. I've been so excited for this Sunday because we have three services we're doing today. The Christmas Eve candlelight service is always one of my favorites. And we end that by singing, you know, we turn the lights down and we have our candles and we sing Silent Night, Holy Night. And it really feels special to me, just very holy, as we remember that God sent Jesus because he loves us. And then the angels, do you remember the first people that the angels went to and announced the birth? Do you remember who they were? They were the shepherds. And the angels appeared to the shepherds and they told them the good news. They said, rejoice, don't be afraid, for born to you this day is a Savior. Who is? Jesus, yes. I'm just so excited for this day. I love to celebrate Jesus's birth and all that means for us. It's an expression of God's love for us, that he would send us a Savior, that he would send us Jesus, and I'm just so excited to celebrate that. And of course, Christmas trees and gifts and all that good stuff, that's fun too. I've got some extra magnets, if you would just pick two families and give them out, okay? Thank you for coming forward. Pick two families and give them out. Pick two families and give them out.
Since almost the beginning of time, God had been telling his people to expect a Savior. Patriarchs and prophets had proclaimed it for years, but also, from the beginning, the promise had been made to a people, a nation, Israel. As time for his entrance drew near, the message seemed to change, to become more personal. With an angel's words to a young virgin from Nazareth, the words, "Born to you this day," began to take on a new meaning.
Almighty God.
when you pack so much into a service, you got to check your little cue card to see what's next. It is sermon time, right? Okay, all right, it is sermon time. It is a joy for us to be able to celebrate openly, in freedom and peace, the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. You may have heard this morning on the news that they're not celebrating Christmas in Bethlehem today because of all the violence. That's a hard truth, but Jesus is still the Prince of Peace. And he came that we might be saved from our sins, and that we might know life abundant here on earth, peaceful, joyful, and eternal in heaven. But sin is still very real in our world. And the sin that you and I do affects not only our relationship with God, it affects other people as well. And we are saved if we have a relationship with Christ, not because we get everything right, not because all of our choices are good. We are saved if we have that relationship with Jesus because he got everything right. Amen. Today we want to look at the Christmas story from the Gospel of Luke. I love reading the Gospel of Luke. Luke had a fondness for angels. I can understand that. What's not to like? Angels are mysterious and majestic messengers from God. They announce usually good things. They guide. They instruct. I believe that they protect people at God's command. All of it at God's command. Angels are just messengers of God. They do whatever God tells them to do. Usually, when angels appear in the scriptures, humans are fearful. And so the first words that angels generally speak have something to do with reassuring folks not to be afraid. Okay? Like the angel Gabriel's appearance in the Old Testament to Daniel. Daniel was so terrified that he fainted. Do you know this story? It's in the 8th chapter of Daniel. Let me read you just a couple of verses. As Gabriel approached the place where I was standing, this is the Daniel speaking, I became so terrified that I fell with my face to the ground. Son of man, he said, you must understand that the events you have seen in your vision relate to the time of the end. While he was speaking, I fainted. And I lay there with my face to the ground. But Gabriel roused me with a touch, and he helped me to my feet. Good old Gabriel. We'll see him again. Whoops. We'll see him again in just a moment. Of course, there's the angel Gabriel's appearance to Zechariah in the temple earlier in this Advent season. We talked about that. Zechariah was a priest, and his wife, of course, is Elizabeth. They will be the parents of John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin. And when the angel appeared to Zechariah, of course, he was terrified too. And the angel's first words to him were, don't be afraid. 6 months later, the angel Gabriel visited a young woman in Nazareth. And this is our next scripture. In the 6th month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. All right, we know this story. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. Now, we're going to pause there for just a minute and talk about Gabriel. We can surmise from his other appearances in the Bible that he appeared human-ish, you know, but different enough to make Daniel faint, to make Zechariah afraid. And so Mary is looking at this angel, Gabriel, and she's a little troubled. I can imagine that her heart is racing just a little bit, you know. Okay, what is this about? Not to mention the fact that Mary is not accustomed to strangers, especially men, speaking to her at all. She has barely just left childhood. Mary is a young, engaged woman, and another man is speaking to her like he knows her. By the human social norms of the day, that was inappropriate and way too familiar. And men didn't casually address young women like that. No wonder Mary is troubled and wondering what sort of a greeting this is. The normal rules for conversation are all broken in the first 30 seconds of this encounter. Mary doesn't know what to say, so prudently, I guess, she says nothing. The angel continues. He even calls her by name. Now it's just getting weird. "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus." You know, most people get to name their own child, but Mary and Joseph are told what to name their firstborn. "You're going to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." This is a lot of information to throw at a teenager in a few seconds, you know. If his first sentence broke the conventions of human speech, his next announcement definitely threatens the conventions of human behavior. If what he says is true and it actually comes to pass, Mary is going to be in quite a bit of trouble with her fiancé and family. At the very least, she will be guilty of a great calendar sin, a pregnancy prior to the wedding. What is going on? "How can this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I'm a virgin." Mary may be young, but she knows a bit about the birds and the bees. The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is now in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God," right? We love that verse, don't we? "Nothing is impossible with God." I like the way the NIV states it. It's the same idea. Nothing is impossible with God. But the NIV says, "For no word from God will ever fail." That has a little more punch to me. No word from God will ever fail. Mary is a faithful person. She's very intelligent. She quickly discerns that this is a God thing. She doesn't understand everything. Her heart is probably still racing as she stares at this messenger from God, this angel. She certainly has more questions. She has a lot of concerns, not the least of which must certainly be, "What are my parents going to say about this?" Still, Mary has a choice to make, and she doesn't seem to have much time to make it. I remember when the Lord called me to go to seminary. The Lord started calling me when I was in college. And I remember I had to think about it for a quick minute. In fact, it took 2 years. Mary was a lot quicker than I was. Maybe the times were simpler. Maybe she just had more faith. I'm not sure. But Mary loves God, and she trusts God. And I find her response to be absolutely magnificent. Staggering in its simplicity and its courage. She says, "I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me according to your word." Read that again to yourself. Isn't that beautiful? "I am the Lord's servant. You know, God made me, I'm his. Let it be with me according to your word. And no word from the Lord ever fails. Let it be with me according to your world. To your word." How would our lives be different if we each responded to God that way? "God, I'm your servant. Let it be with me according to your word." Mary is amazing. And with that response, she freely agrees to a very special and lifelong relationship with the divine. Oh, the things she will witness, the things that she herself will experience, the things that she'll feel, the joys, the pride, but also the pain and the anguish. You remember what was it that old Simeon told her shortly after the birth? Do you remember old Simeon? They were taking Jesus to dedicate him in the temple. And there was this old guy, this old prophet standing there. And when he saw Jesus, he said, "May I hold him?" And he held him. And he pronounced a blessing on him. And he turned to Mary and he said, "A sword will pierce your own soul too." Whew. I wonder if a chill ran down her spine. What do you mean a sword is going to... This is a happy day. This is a happy day. Just say Merry Christmas and be done. You know? A sword will pierce your own soul, too. I'm quite sure Mary pondered those words for a long time. I bet they came echoing back to her years later when she stood weeping at the foot of the cross and watching her son die. I am convinced that there is a great grace in the fact that we cannot see very far down the road. Can I get an amen? Amen. If we could see it now, I think it would stop us in our tracks. Paralyzed with fear. Thinking that maybe if we don't go that way, if we don't do this, if we don't move, everything will be fine. But that's not the world in which we live. And more than that, it's not God's calling to us. He didn't say, "Be safe and never take a risk," did he? He said, "Walk by faith, not by sight." You can trust God today. You can trust God tomorrow. You can trust God next year, whether there's a public celebration of Christmas or not. God can be trusted. Because no word from God ever fails. Back to our story. Mary said yes to God's plan. She said yes to her participation in it. That is amazing and brave. But the baby will still need an earthly father. And this untimely pregnancy causes a number of problems for Mary. The most notable, of course, being with her fiancé. The Gospel of Luke tells us of Mary's response. The Gospel of Matthew tells us of Joseph's response to all of this. And it's not unexpected. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. This is Matthew narrating, telling us. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Okay? I'm sure Mary told Joseph, but again, that's kind of a lot to handle in the moment, you know? But he did love her. He didn't want to hurt her. He didn't want her to get stoned to death. Those were all possibilities. So he was just going to quietly call off the marriage. He loves Mary, but he's faithful to the law. He loves God too. And this is not right. At least that's his first inclination. This is not right. And so he looks for a way to quietly annul the marriage. We can imagine how crushing this must have been for Joseph after he's heard from Mary, but he hadn't yet heard from God. How? Why? How could this happen? With whom? This can't be happening. All those plans that we made together, those dreams that we dreamed together, evaporating like a morning mist. But God is not trying to break the young couple up. God is, in fact, very merciful, and God doesn't leave Joseph to fret too long, to sweat it out. Indeed, God has plans for both of them in the life of baby Jesus. But after Joseph had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Now, this is his dream, okay? He sees an angel, and he's hearing this. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their, what? Sins. He will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means what? God with us. God with us. That wonderful reassurance. God's word never fails. Jesus is Emmanuel, despite the circumstances that rage around us. Jesus is Emmanuel. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Remember, they've both been told, by the way, I've already chosen the name, God says, his name will be Jesus. Can you imagine for a moment how Joseph must have felt when he woke from that dream? Oh, thank you, God. Thank you. Mary was telling the truth. This is wonderful. This is a miraculous God thing, and we're going to have a baby. We don't get to pick the name, but that's okay. We're going to have a baby. We can imagine the weight that must have lifted from his heart and his mind and his shoulders. His betrothed was not unfaithful to him. In fact, just the opposite. Joseph and Mary are so full of faith that God invites them into a special relationship with God himself. I bet Joseph woke up and ran immediately over to Mary's house. I bet the parents were watching in consternation, trying to figure out what was going on, but apparently the wedding was back on. And that's how love came down at Christmas. Do you know that hymn? I think we sang it a week or two ago. Love came down at Christmas. Love all lovely, love divine. Love was born at Christmas. Star and angels gave the sign. The words were written by the noted Victorian poet Christina Rossetti in 1885. She also wrote In the Bleak Midwinter. We sang that a couple of weeks ago, too. But she's talking about the incarnation. Love came down at Christmas. She's talking about God coming in human form. Now, Mary and Joseph will still have some difficulties, we know. They'll still have some explaining to do. People will ask questions. You know how people are. They'll, you know, calculate and look at the calendar and, you know, wait a minute, you know. We aren't told whether they confided in their families or not. We're not told whether their families believed them or not, or how much support they had from their families. But we do know that they had support from Elizabeth and Zechariah. That's good. The circumstances may cause a few problems for the young couple, but it's interesting to me that God doesn't seem too concerned with violations of human social decorum. Mary and Joseph, like all young couples and new parents, will work out the problems as they arise. What we don't want to overlook is how God is doing something amazing here. The incarnation. It means in the flesh. God being born of a woman. It is extraordinary. The immortal putting on mortality. Talk about breaking conventions. Nobody saw that one coming. This is the doctrine of the incarnation. It's a fancy theological term for God becoming human. But doctrines are helpful. They're like road maps. They help us understand what is going on and how to get where we need to be. And so you and I need to get our minds around what God is doing in Jesus. He loved us enough to become one of us in order to show us the way and save us from our sins. Instructing us from a distance just wasn't working, was it? We weren't getting it. And in fact, by this time, humanity has pretty much messed things up so badly that only God can fix them. And so, in the incarnation, God does for us what we could not do for ourselves. He bridged the chasm between us that sin had created. And he opened up a way for us to get across that great divide to get back to God. I like this image, okay? You see the distance between us and God. We're here. We've fallen. God's here. He's perfect. And Jesus is the way back to a right relationship with God. You can have a right relationship with God here in this life, and you can be saved for eternal life in heaven. But how are we going to do it? Only through Jesus. That's why this is so important. By living a sinless life, the only person ever to do so, and then offering himself as a sacrifice on our behalf, Jesus paid the price for our sin. If you know your Old Testament history, you know that Jesus is the unblemished lamb who made of himself the ultimate sacrifice of atonement for sin. The Old Testament says, without the shedding of blood, there can be no atonement. And so Jesus is the unblemished lamb who atones for our sins. And in so doing, he opens the way back up to God. He bridges that distance. Verses 2 and 3 of Love Came Down at Christmas. Worship we the Godhead, love incarnate, love divine. Worship we our Jesus, but wherewith? For sacred sign. Love shall be our token, love be yours and love be mine. Love to God and all people, love for plea and gift and sign. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. He gave us Jesus. It is a powerful demonstration that God so loves the world, God so loves every human being in every locale on this planet, that God became flesh in the person of Jesus Christ so he could show us the way home. As we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we can walk close to God in this life. We can worship him and love him and serve him. We have a heart full of gratitude. Love is our token, as the poet wrote. It's our badge of honor that we belong to Jesus, right? As we reflect that love. My friends, love came down at Christmas. And despite our sin and despite our wars and despite disease and death, that love has never departed our world. Merry Christmas. Amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy had come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy was Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy
would one day rule the nations. Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? That sleeping child you're holding is the great I am.
Sing, go tell it on the mountain. Why on the mountain? They didn't have PA systems over there then. So you speak from the mountain and it'll carry out all the things.
Worshiping with us this morning. We do have another service at 4 p.m. That's our traditional Christmas Eve candlelight communion service. We invite you back for that one. It'll be different music, different message, same Jesus. Amen? Same Jesus we're going to be talking about. Go in peace and have a wonderful Merry Christmas and pray for our world and proclaim the good news of Jesus. Amen.